Welcome, friends, to the second day of the celebration. This is called a post-Bhandara light meditation day. Light because the rest of the stuff was very heavy. But today it will be light. We'll have things that we are normally thinking are playful. Like all of us, or most of us, trying to make a visit to the roof, to our astral bodies, to our imaginary bodies, and picking up gifts that Great Master places for some of us every time he assembles here. How many of you have had opportunity to pick up gifts from top of the roof, astral gifts? Wow, that's a big number. GM has to work hard. How many of you have never picked up any gift from the top? Better luck today. The second light part of today will be in the afternoon. We'll come down to the real playful things. I use playing cards. Some people think it's too big a fall for me to talk from high stuff about Bachkan and then talk about little playing card tricks on the table. But I feel that we came from our high place. We came from our true home, our Satkhand. Satkhand means true home. We came where we were blissfully living as souls within the totality of the true creator of everything, our true father who gave birth to us as souls, and we decided to come. A small percentage of us came from the population for an adventure. We were told that if you go into new levels of creation, new levels of worlds being created, you will have a spirit of adventure. And we are given a very nice architect, the power to go and create new worlds, new dimensions, new types of experiences. And it will be a great adventure. And so the great creator took a vote. He said, how many of you would like to go and go into a spirit of adventure and enjoy the new area? And we all raised our hands. And the rest did not. The rest are still there. It is estimated that it was about 10% only who raised their hands. And therefore 90% have never left our true home. And they are in a state of bliss all the time, because that's the state one has to live in. And when they are in a state of bliss, and they are dancing and singing as souls in their true home, they feel they are in beyond all problems, beyond mind, beyond physical words, beyond this difficult situation of duality and so on. They are in a very great spirit of dance and music, and they are having a good time. We decided to come and have an adventure. Now, adventure did not mean suffering. Adventure meant joy. Playfulness. We came into this creation for playfulness. We were told whatever equipment you need, you can take with you. And we said, okay, we'll take an equipment by which we can make this adventure land into a big, huge place where we can really roam around. So we were given a mind and an accessory which was able to create time and space. And that which was bottled up, an experience which was bottled up in one moment, was stretched out into infinite time and infinite space. There was no limit. The limit of infinity is as far as you can go. That's the limit. And since we could go as far as we liked in the time available to us, we got an opportunity to have this adventure as far as we like, for as long as we like. So we came here and we wanted to have experiences of every kind. We wanted to have experience of pleasure, joy. We found it was impossible to have an experience of pleasure if we did not create an opposite of that. The experiences in time and space are only created in pairs of opposites. If you take away one part, the other one disappears with it. So we came up with the idea that we must have some pain to have pleasure. And we must have pleasure to experience pain. We must have darkness to have light. We must have light to create darkness. So we used this pairs of opposite principle, and we came into this big world of pairs of opposites, and we said this is a great place to have fun and enjoy ourselves. Then we said we need something more basic to enjoy that we are creating. These concepts of space and time, these concepts of pain and pleasure are not good enough for us. These concepts must be translated into ideas and made into concrete things. So from the world of concepts, which was the causal world created by our minds, we created the world of ideas, which was the astral plane. There we could turn everything into, from a concept into an idea that could be played out by our imagination. We weren't satisfied with that. Imagination wasn't good enough. We want to solidify, it should look so solid, so real, more real than our true home. So we created a physical plane of matter, of molecules and atoms and electrons, electromagnetic plates and vibrations. We created a system by which we could make even hollow spaces and hollow time into something filled up. And we created this physical world to have adventure and a good time here. That was the purpose, intention of our coming here. Are we living up to our intention? What went wrong? Something went wrong that today we are complaining for being here. Today we want to run back to our true home. We knew right from the beginning we are here for a temporary reason. We are here only temporarily. And out of the 10%, 1%, only 1/10 of the adventure-seeking souls that came here before leaving Sachkhand, our true home, turned around to the Creator and said, what if we don't like the adventure? What if we are troubled by it? And the Creator said, don't worry, if you are really troubled by it and you don't want to stay there anymore, I'll bring you back. How will you bring us back? Because we'll be probably trapped there for a long time. He said, don't worry. Whenever you are ready and you feel fed up with that adventure of yours and want to come back, I will myself come in the same form in which you exist there, in a human form. When you are seeking me, I will hear your seeking, I will come back in human form and bring you back to our home. Can you imagine? We sitting here are that 1%. We seekers all over the universe, all over the world, and many seekers in other levels, sitting right now in the astral plane, in the causal plane, in the place not yet materialized into the physical world, are all part of that 1%. The 1% is pretty large. When you imagine that the 1% of soul does not represent 1% of human beings, it represents trillions of other beings in different species. It has been said in one of the old texts in India that there are 8.4 million species, said. They talk in terms of lakhs, a lakh is 100,000. 84 lakhs, that would be equivalent to 8.4 million species. And they listed them. Out of 8.4, 5.4 million are in the plant life alone. And then they go on giving the description of the other species. And the final 400,000 includes a human species, as well as all the species of angels, gods, creators, sub-creators at all other levels. It's a huge system, a huge place, and these are all represented by 1% of those who are singing and dancing, our brethren and sisters left behind. Oh, they're not brothers and sisters, they have no sex there. They're all unisex people there. Anyway, we are here for that adventure. Something went wrong, that instead of enjoying our adventure for which we came, we totally forgot about it and began to think that the real world which we created, which we think is the only reality, we forgot everything else. We tried to make it so real by forgetting anything else exists. We tried to make it so real that we shut ourselves in our awareness only to that which is in front of us and said, this is the place we want to have an experience. And then we got attached to the experience. We got attached to our minds. We got attached to the equipment we were given. A very beautiful equipment was given to us to surround ourselves. It was called a surround system. It was called the human mind. The mind surrounded us. The mind enveloped the consciousness, which was our soul. And the mind began to work and starting to think, desire, attach, follow attachments. We loved it. That's what we came for the adventure of the mind. We communicated, we sang, we talked, we thought, we created languages. We created songs. And they enjoyed all that because that was the purpose of having a mind. We created the many so that we could communicate with the many. We loved the many. We had relationships. It was a very great experience to have all these adventures. And then we began to think, we are the mind. Biggest blunder we could have made. We began to identify the self. The self is the mind. Instead of saying, we are consciousness, the soul, we have been given a mind to use, we began to think, we are the mind. Beginning of all troubles. The mind was set in motion to create memories and hold on to memories. Memory making was a very big equipment product of that mind, the memories that could be created. What was the memory? Memory was merely a design to create an event which looks real. Do you know that what we are experiencing now in the physical world as daily occurrences are no more than recall of memory? There's nothing more in it. Now why do I say it's recall of memory? Because of the very nature of time into which we have placed it. If you look at time, we are passing through time. What is time as we know it? How do we experience time? We know time only as past, present and future. We have no notion of time otherwise. What has gone is past. What is happening now is present. What is still to come is the future. That's what we think. We forget one very important element. Let's start with the present. The present has no time at all. Not even a nanosecond. When we say now, by the time I have said now, it's past. Before I said it, it's future. Where did the now come? When did the present hold on? Present has no time whatsoever. It's a slipping from the future to the past continuously. Continuously, the time that we are experiencing as real is merely the future slipping into the past. That means, are we experiencing the past? Can we experience the past? Only one way, by recall of a memory. No other way. You can never have an experience of the past brought back into life except through memory or recall. So if the past can only be lived through memory, what about the future? Since there is no time in the present, we only have two areas of time to examine. The past can only be lived through memory. The future, what is future? Have you ever contemplated if three words were taken away from our dictionaries, hope, fear, anticipation, take these three functions out from our life, there is no future at all. Future consists only of hoping, anticipating and fearing. And how do we do this? We do in so-called present, which is past. Therefore, when we think we are talking of the future, we are really again looking at the past. There is indeed, if you examine carefully, there is no difference between the future and the past because we are using memory for both. Time having no time at all, and the only experience we can have is in the timeless now. The only experience being generated as a current, regular, real experience is happening through memory of the past. Therefore, all we needed to create this whole live experience, which we take for so real, is occurring just because we have picked up a memory capsule from the causal plane. When people say we make our destinies and pick up our destinies, what were the destinies in form of? What was the form of the destiny? What is the tape that we picked up and created this life? Is nothing but a capsule containing a memory. Once we install the memory which we picked up into our individuated mind, it became our life. It not only became our life, it became all our lives because the causal plane ordained that we use the memory in a linear time, creating an effect which is called the cause and effect relationship. That nothing can be experienced in memory which does not have a cause and does not have an effect. This was a remarkable thing that we created in order to make this a reality, that the cause and effect must take place. Therefore, we created a law of cause and effect, which today we call the law of karma, which has bound us down to relive this memory only through the law of cause and effect. When were the cause and effects determined? When we picked up the memory capsule. We picked up the cause capsule for ourselves, for our enjoyment, for our adventure. We had many choices. We could have picked up any one of those different capsules. If you do meditation now, and go up to the causal plane, you can see all the capsules stored up there. You can pick up any one of them and relive that again. Maybe some of you may be surprised that you have relived some of those capsules earlier and rejected them and gone back and picked up new ones. The whole system of creating an adventure was based upon our reliving our memories. And the memory created the past. There was no past. People say, oh, what would I have done in my past life? So I ask them, which past life are you talking of? What would happen if you left your home, such kind today, and came into this physical existence? How would you have a physical existence? You have to have a karma for that. How could you have karma when you weren't here at all? How could you possibly have a past to create a karma and then bring you here when you were not here at all? The karma was built into the capsule itself. When you picked up your capsule for one lifetime by being born once as a human being here, you picked up along with it all your past lives. How many past lives? Infinite. Which means you can go backwards as long as you like, you can keep on seeing your past lives. When did you pick up? One moment. When you drew out your capsule from the causal plane. How much future life do you have? Infinite. Because every karma that you create in the present life has a future. Cause and effect. So when we pick up our one lifetime here, just one lifetime, we pick up all past lifetimes and all future lifetimes. It's such a remarkable system that you create time in no time. The experience of real flow of time, when there's actually no time in the now, in which the only experience, only moment when you can have an experience is now. And now has no time. And yet it looks like we are passing through time all the time. We're creating this past and future through functions of the mind. And it's a beautiful experience. It was so easy to do it. The setup was so beautiful, so perfect, so easily done. Where did we get wrong? We made a mistake to think that we are the mind. We made a second mistake to think that the karma is real. We made a third mistake to take this body that's going through the adventure, which we wore as a mask, as a costume, to go through the adventure, is our real self. We made blunder after blunder, and we put ourselves in this horrible shape that we are in now, that we have to say, Master, take us back home. Otherwise, we would say, we are very happy enjoying this adventure. It's a temporary thing. We're going to go back anyway. We got a promise from the ultimate creator, whose kids we are, whose children we are. We know we are going to go back. We have no doubt about it. We got an assurance from the very creative power that put us here. We would never have any worry. Now, if somebody comes to know the reality of all that I am saying, all this picture that I have drawn before you, this is how the flow of consciousness took place and brought us to this. If you just know all this, not academically, not intellectually, but experientially, if you know it experientially, could you ever have any worry? Never be worried about anything. There's no reason to worry. The fact that you can merely have an experience telling you that this is what happened takes away all your worry, takes away all the tensions and stresses that we are going through. We would enjoy the show. We would enjoy the show that look how beautiful the costumes are. We have created millions and billions of characters. And look at each one has a separate body. Each one has a separate identifiable iris in the eye. Each one has a separate line which can be identified on the fingertips. We have made so much diversity in this great adventure. And then we are enjoying the show and seeing the interaction of the players. It's one of the biggest shows that can ever be set up. And we are out here sitting inside the covers which we created to put up the props, the mind, the sensory perception. This body, a prop for the show. We put them up to enjoy the show. Why don't we go back and sit on our audience, in the audience where we are supposed to sit? Just because the body that we wear is a character in the show does not mean we should take the body to be ourselves. I tell you, if we sit in the proper seat from where we can watch this show, we'll start enjoying the adventure all over again and forget about all the problems. Which is the proper seat where you should sit? Which is not associated with this body, but is inside the body. Because the body has been created around us. Sensory systems around us. Mind around us. We are inside all that. If you go within yourself, to the point where all these are surroundings of yours, you'll enjoy the show once again and know how it was set up. I wish we could all do that. I want you to sit in that place. At least in the body, you know it's behind the eyes, where consciousness is operating right now. Shall we do it? All ready? Close your eyes and sit behind the eyes. The body is merely a cover, merely a house in which you have been placed. This house has six stories divided by energy levels. The six chakras represent the six levels, the six floors of this house. You are already sitting on the sixth floor behind the eyes. Don't go down. Don't seek where the heart is, where the other organs of the body are. Just sit behind the eyes. The physical eyes are in front of you. The physical ears are on either side of you. Your head is on top of you. Your throat is below you. Your nose is in front of you and slightly below you. Recognize your body as a cover upon yourself. You are not the body. You are sitting inside your body. Right behind your eyes. Look at the darkness in front created by your closed eyes. You see images and pictures and colors floating around. Ignore them. Move backwards to the center of the head. Center yourself between the eyes and behind them, as far as you can guess, is the exact central point between your ears. Imagine a suitable sitting place there. Imagine a nice chair to sit on. Imagine a cushion. Imagine a floor. Whatever makes you comfortable, sit there to watch the show. Do not slide forward. Stay in the center. With your imaginary hands, imaginary legs, you can push yourself backward whenever you like. If you feel the picture in front of you is drawing you forward, push yourself back. Stay in the center. Don't think of anything else except the center and what is around you, inside the head. Think of who you are. What is your shape? What do you look like? Behind the eyes. What else is around you? What images are you seeing? Don't follow the images. Stay in the center. No thinking of anything outside. Think only of what is inside. Change your thoughts. Think of what is inside. Look at yourself. Look at your hands. Look at your feet inside. What shape are you in? Is it a constant shape or changing shape? Are you light or heavy? Are you fat or slim? Can you walk or fly? Test these things about yourself. Are you tied down to the floor or can you go up to the ceiling? Test yourself. Stay in the center. Don't move around too much. Look around if you can on all sides, but stay in the center. Ignore any images that come in front of you. Let them pass. Let them move from side to side and go away. Stay in the center. Watch them like you watch a TV. Don't follow them. Don't think about them. Think about yourself. Don't follow any sounds that you hear. Stay in the center. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Welcome back to the physical world you created from the proper seat from which you should have been watching this show all the time. How many of you discovered that that's the right place to be in? Very good. Good progress. All meditation that we are going to do in our meditation workshops should be done from that location. If you do not have that location, do not even start. Those of you who have been initiated and have been told the practice of repetition of words, how to repeat the five words, they should be repeated by you sitting there. Not by the physical body at all. Your mind should be made to repeat them. The thinking process, which thinks all the time, should be made to turn the thinking into those words. And you have to listen to the sound current within. That's the place to listen to. Great Master said, you should not even begin to meditate unless you have first located yourself at the third eye center. Today I was trying to guide you to the third eye center, which is behind these eyes. And if you are comfortable being there, your meditation will be very successful. Till you take time to establish yourself on a regular basis by going to that place regularly, from morning, sometime in the morning, sometime at night before going to sleep, you cannot expect meditation to be successful merely as a ritual, merely as an outward practice. Meditation has to be done at that point. That's the starting point of meditation, to dissociate yourself from the physical body and to be inside. That is still many layers to cross even then. This is the very first step, that you should be able to go to the third eye center, behind the eyes, and then start your meditation. How many of you enjoyed this few minutes? Very good. How many of you felt it was boredom? Not worth doing it? No nays yet? All yes. Very good. I'm very happy to see the progress. This group is really very blessed that so many of you are. You need a reward for this. And the greatness of the reward is in the form of astral packages. Some of you are going to get them. And they are being placed on the roof of this building right now. And they are gifts from great masters. They are not physical gifts. Nor do you have to go physically to collect them. You have to go through your astral bodies. Have you ever known your astral bodies, what they are? Astral bodies are bodies created by your imagination. People make so much, they mystify you by talking of an astral self or something so far away from us. Without realizing, we are using our astral bodies all the time when we are awake in the physical body. The sense perception that you are getting are all based on your astral bodies. Physical bodies have no sense organs. These organs operate only when you are alive, wakeful, with the astral body in it. The wakefulness is created by the astral body, and then only they function. These eyes can be open and you are sleeping, you don't see anything. Eyes don't see. Only when you awake, you can see with these eyes. His ears can't hear. The physical organs only operate when the astral sensory systems are working in it. All the sensory systems are contained in the astral body. If you leave your physical body by death or by meditation, you will find all these sensory systems working completely all right. They go away with the astral body, not with the physical. When we say imaginary, it's not imaginary. It looks imaginary because we are taking this as a reality. We are taking the physical as the only reality. Therefore, any function of sensory systems outside the body, we think is imaginary. For example, if you want to think of a tree outside, you can all imagine a tree, you can see the tree. How do you see the tree? Not with these eyes, the tree is outside. You see it, what you say is your imagination. It's not imagination. It looks imagination because you distinguish it from the reality of the physical system and the physical body. That's how you create imagination. Supposing you pull your attention from here and are unaware of your physical body, the astral body will be more real than the physical body ever has been. Test it out. Therefore, these realities are created by our attention. Wherever bulk of our attention is, creates that reality. Bulk of our attention is in the physical body, so this has become real. So when you are sitting in a physical body and you use your imagination to do something, you are taking part in the astral system. You're taking part in the astral body. So that is why these astral gifts that have been placed in packages on top of this house, on this tomb, they have been packaged so that your astral body can go and see, recognize. If you find there's a package sitting for you, go and take it. It's meant for you. Then you can open the package while you're still up on the roof, or you can open the package when you come down, you can bring it down. You can go up. You don't need to climb stairs or anything. You can go right up, like my good friend Jewel once did. She said she has never had experience of flying, but when the gift came, she flew right through the ceiling. She went up. You can go like this. You can go from outside. If you're not confident of hitting your head against the ceiling, then you can go from outside. Find any way, imaginative way to go up. Go upstairs, see what's lying there, and if you can find a gift, take it. Open it, bring it down. If it's a unique gift, I will ask you to describe it. If it is something that you've already seen, or is a routine gift, then you don't have to say anything. If it is a gift that you don't understand what it means, you can ask me later on privately, during interviews, I'll explain to you what the significance of the gift is. Each gift has its own significance that you will get, and it's being plucked from the astral plane of consciousness, an astral world in which we are also simultaneously living without our attention and wakefulness there. Are you ready? Okay, close your eyes. Imagine that you are going on top of the roof. Fly to the top of the roof and look around in your imagination. If you find a gift, pick it up. take your time, no hurry. Now hurry up, pick up your gift if you haven't done so. Come down, keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Welcome back. Let me use my special glasses to see the gift you brought. How many of you were able to get some gifts? Congratulations. Congratulations. I'm very happy. How many? Anybody got a unique gift you'd like to share with others? Right now you can do that. Yes, Suzanne.
It's like a dark green ring. Like a vortex. When I look into it, it's like a vortex of blue and white.
That's beautiful. Did you like it?
Yeah, I don't know what it means.
You know very well this color, the colors of crystals and blues and all that is very popular in the astral plane. You see a lot of it. And you just picked up one of the nice gifts, and the vortex is the energy in those, and that's a natural energy in the astral plane, in most of the things. You see that the streets are paved with things which have energy, the houses are paved with energy, the different institutions there are also bursting with energy and vortices. The vortex is a natural phenomenon there. So you picked up the right stuff from the astral plane. Congratulations. Anybody else want to share? Yes, David.
When I got to the roof, it was all dark. There was stars and planets, colors, colorful planets. And then there was a box. And in there, everything that was outside was in there as well, with infinite depth inside the box.
Did you expect that? Did you expect to see that?
Not exactly.
Congratulations. You saw a very good representation of how the outside is created from the inside. Not only in the astral plane, the same principle also applies to this plane, also applies to the causal plane, applies to the whole of creation. That the inside is created first and then that appears and projects outside. Congratulations. Anybody else? Yes?
I got a lady's white hanky with embroidery on it.
Is that your favorite? Did you like it?
I don't know what it means.
It means a hanky with embroidery. It doesn't mean more than that. It probably represents some of your subconscious tastes. It's just a reflection of what is buried as a subconscious taste of embroidery, artwork, of that kind, craft or something. If you do that, you'll be successful. Anybody else? Something unique? Yes?
I looked around, I didn't see anything right away, and that just looked like an ordinary roof, you know. And then
you saw the roof?
Yeah, I was on the roof, and I saw it.
You saw the roof?
Yes.
That's good enough.
Well,
that was good enough.
That was good
sitting
enough,
sitting right? Here, you
yeah,
saw the roof.
Then I saw this little box, and I picked it up, and I opened it up, and it looked like a crystal, but it was like a pool. It's very beautiful. It was a beautiful color, white, and it was shiny and beautiful, like a diamond almost. But then I looked at it more closely, and I could see like it was moving. There were faces there, there was a face there, and I looked again, and it looked like all the time.
You didn't expect that.
No,
you got a very good gift. You understand it also. Congratulations. Okay. Now, anybody else? We can have one more recital. Yes, Chuck?
It was very unusual. It was like a carrying case for eyeglasses. It was quite large. And the underside was black. Draping over the top were red. It was kind of an arrow projected down. Then the higher up it went, became very bright and brilliant, almost, like the sun. And it was an image of something individual. It didn't have, well, it wasn't an animal, but it was a kind of a human shape, almost like an alien. And it was very brilliant on top. But totally mystifies me. But
you didn't expect that.
No.
Well, it's obvious that you could not have imagined that. See the power of imagination, that we think we only imagine what we know. That's not true. You can draw a lot of things from the astral plane through imagination, which you cannot imagine if you only had exposure to the physical plane. So that's why you just saw the kind of glasses the aliens wear in the astral plane, which are all lit up and bright by themselves. In fact, almost all the objects that you will see while you are traversing the astral plane in meditation will be lit up and bright. It's a very beautiful sight. Thank you very much for sharing, Chuck. Anji, that's Bibi Raj.
I never had such things before, really, meditation for long years. But this time, you were explaining, but all of a sudden your song was disappearing from my ears. But I saw a sky of like a golden water ocean. I'm looking up, but it's all I can feel that the ocean of golden water was waving around my head. And a few cups coming boat a little bit, very far. And somebody is sitting, but I suspect he was sitting out there.
you overshot the mark. You were supposed to go to the astral plane, you went to the causal.
So sitting like that, and he told to me, breathing and well, then I was open. You said open your eyes.
Okay, I'm sorry you opened too early. Thank you very much. Thank you. Beautiful experience. That's a beautiful experience.
So that I can say what is
that is the reflection in the causal ocean, the reflection of the sky itself is like golden. The sky itself is golden, the ocean is golden, and it reflects the same way like you're describing. And the boat that we ride are some of the adventures that we take in the causal plane. So you are very lucky that in this little experience you went overshot the mark, as I said.
I was thinking that you were spreading the ocean inside and hiding from me in the boat.
Then I have to hide sometimes. See, the BB is from, Raj is from India and has seen masters there. He's currently well known to perfect living masters and has had experience with them. And she has an interesting story which I shared with some of you about how her father, who was a police officer in the area where the great master Dera was, how he was initiated on horseback. Normally initiations did not take place on horseback. They took place in a small initiation room. But in her dad's case, it happened there. So maybe I will request her to tell this. Why don't you come here?
You know.
Her father, who was a police officer around in the jurisdiction around the Dera, he used to come occasionally to meet great master and check on how things were in the Dera. So on one of his visits, he was accompanied by some other police officers on horses, and the great master, who loved horse riding himself, you might have seen some of his pictures and glimpses of great master riding a horse. He praised the horse. He said, "This is a nice horse." And dad said, "Would you like to ride on one?" And so one of the officers gave his horse to the great master, and her dad and the great master rode on that horse. And he signaled to the others that the other police officers should not accompany him. So he sent them back, the police men who were accompanying the inspector. And so where they were going, great master asked her dad, "You would like to be initiated?" He had never heard that before, so he said, "Yes, master, I've been coming as an officer in this jurisdiction, but sure." He said, "All right, I'll initiate you." So he told him the five words to repeat of Simran, and as he repeated, the great master spoke up those words, her dad spoke up those words in turn. When all the five were done, he said, "You are initiated." So that was a great event, very unique event that happened. After the riders ride back, great master said, "While I was speaking those words to initiate you, these horses have also heard those words, and they are also initiated." And since horses are not normally initiated, human beings are initiated, what have we to do now? So there was a parade later on of police officers, and several horses came there, and two of them fell from the bluff of that river into the river. And they were the same two horses, and they were never found. The bodies were never found of those horses. And this is a unique event that happened in the life of her father. So she has these stories, she has many more stories too, which happened in the Dera and outside. If you get a chance at lunchtime to sit around her, she'll tell you more stories. And if you want her stories translated to American English, then David is here to do that.
We're working on that.
He's already working on it. Okay, I'm very happy that. How many of you got unique gifts? Which is surprising. The others who could not get gifts, don't feel disappointed, you have another chance. In the spiritual path, you always get another chance. Always get another chance. This is amazing. It's not two chances or three chances. It doesn't say three strikes till you're out. In the spiritual path, you're never out. And you keep on getting more chances. We'll have a break for lunch, and then we reassemble in the afternoon, and we'll have some further light moments. If you're not human, you cannot be a perfect living master. If you're not more human than most human beings, you can't be a perfect living master. The masters come to be like us, completely like us, so we can befriend them, experience love for them, and share our concerns with them, and they become true friends. They become friends for life. They don't become friends for a little while. Once they initiate somebody, that relationship is forever, to eternity, till we even beyond eternity, even beyond time, till we reach our own home. It's a great relationship. So that is why some of you got initiated yesterday, some have been initiated earlier. I congratulate all of you. And all those who are sitting here are seekers, you will be initiated one day. It's a guarantee. Otherwise, you wouldn't be having seeking in your heart. So that's why I congratulate all of you who have come here for this occasion. Okay, we'll have a break for lunch now, and we'll reassemble later in the afternoon. Thank you very much. Okay.